नो स्ट्रेस ऑफ एक्ने, हर्चुसम वॉइस वॉइस चेंज एंड नो स्ट्रेस ऑफ फैटिक, नो स्ट्रेस ऑफ ब्रेथलेसनेस एंड नो स्ट्रेस ऑफ चेस्ट पेन। मेंस्ट्रुअल हिस्ट्री, शी अटेंड मेनार्क एट द एज ऑफ 12, शी हैव ए रेगुलर साइकिल 3 by 30 days, विच इज मॉडरेट एंड रेगुलर इन फ्लो, नॉट एसोसिएटेड विद पेन एंड नो क्लॉट्स पास्ड अलॉन्ग द मेंस्ट्रुएशन। लास्ट डेट ऑफ मेंस्ट्रुअल पीरियड वॉज 3rd July 2021। मैरिटल हिस्ट्री, मैरिड एट 20 years ऑफ एज, मैरिज वॉज नॉन कंसेंजिनियस मैम। पास्ट ऑब्स्टेट्रिक हिस्ट्री, शी हैव ऑब्स्टेट्रिक कोड ऑफ पैरा वन लाइव वन। फर्स्ट चाइल्ड बर्थ वॉज एट 22 years ऑफ एज बाई नॉर्मल वेजनल डिलीवरी एंड चाइल्ड इज नाउ हेल्दी मैम। पास हिस्ट्री, नो हिस्ट्री ऑफ सिमिलर सिम्टम्स इन पास्ट, नो हिस्ट्री ऑफ डायबिटीज, हाइपर टेंशन, आस्थमा, एपिलेप्सी, टीबी, थायरॉयड डिसऑर्डर्स, नो हिस्ट्री ऑफ ब्लड ट्रांसफ्यूजन, नो हिस्ट्री ऑफ ट्रीटमेंट फॉर ओव्यूलेशन इंडक्शन एंड नो हिस्ट्री ऑफ प्रीवियस सर्जरी। फैमिली हिस्ट्री, नो हिस्ट्री ऑफ सिमिलर कंप्लेंट्स इन मदर, नो हिस्ट्री ऑफ मैलिग्नेंसी लाइक ओवेरियन, कोलॉन, प्रोस्टेट, पैनक्रियास, ब्रेस्ट एक्सेट्रा इन फैमिली। पर्सनल हिस्ट्री, पेशेंट कंज्यूम्स मिक्स डाइट, नो स्लीप डिस्टर्बेंस, नो हिस्ट्री ऑफ टोबैको एंड एल्कोहल इनटेक, नो हिस्ट्री ऑफ वर्किंग इन एस्बेस्टोस फैक्ट्री।
Okay, wait, wait.
जनरल
That's fine.
यस
Before
मैम,
we go on to examination, wait. Now tell me
यस
now,
मैम।
summarize your history. What have you incurred from the history? Tell me what complaint has come from.
Patient is come with complaint of abdominal distension for past 6 months, ma'am, and a pain for last 1 month.
Okay, so you have a now is age important for this patient?
Yes, ma'am. She is 42 years old, so
So you have a
that is.
48-year-old woman who's coming to
Yes,
you with
ma'am.
abdominal distension and abdominal pain, right? Now tell
Yes,
me
ma'am.
what differentials you can have in your mind. What are the reasons?
Like.
See, and see, you haven't elaborated now. This pain, you said this
Yes, ma'am.
pain is always like dull aching and all that. Fine. Now,
Yes, ma'am.
is it important to note whether it increases during her menstruation or not? Does she have dysmenorrhea, or does the pain increase during period or not? Does it have relevance?
Yes, ma'am.
Why?
Like during endometrial cancer, it can there can be pain
We don't
present, ma'am.
focus on cancer at 48 years. Okay,
Okay, ma'am.
at 48 years, you have an entire array of differentials because you know your diagnosis. You cannot go and say think every time in terms of cancer. At 48
Yes,
years, you
ma'am.
have the entire spectrum of benign gynecological conditions. Right? She could have a fibroid after all. See
Yes,
how do you
ma'am.
know she's coming to you with an abdominal distension and pain? She can have see can a subserous fibroid present like this? Dull aching pain 6 months. Okay,
Yes.
can she have or not
No, ma'am.
distension and pain?
No, ma'am. It is not associated with pain, ma'am.
No, you said the patient has got pain, right?
Yes,
Only
ma'am.
abdominal. She's got lower abdominal pain, right?
Yes, ma'am.
All right. So she and the see, supposing it's a fibroid, does she need to have pain? She needn't have pain. Subserous fibroid can come to you with only distension. She can have a dull aching pain, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes or no? So you
Yes, ma'am.
see, based on your history, I want to know what are the things you would like to rule out. You understand? So first thing is, or what are the things you have in your mind based on your history? These are the things I would like to rule out. You should give me a list like that. So I'm telling you, so based on your organ, just tell me, uterus. Now, what are the things? See, she's got lower abdomen pain, you said, right?
Yes, ma'am.
So what are the things can come into your mind? Her only positive history is she's 48 years. She's got abdominal distension and lower abdomen pain, right? So,
Yes, ma'am.
and see, what are the reasons you can for abdominal distension? Say lower abdominal distension. What are the reasons? Tell me what all reasons she can have lower abdominal distension.
Like fibroid,
She
ascites.
can have some mass abdomen, right?
Yes, ma'am.
She can
Yes,
have
ma'am.
a mass abdomen. So the mass can be from the uterus, in which case it's a fibroid. The mass can be from the ovary, which can be any ovarian mass. Okay. It can
Yes,
be
ma'am.
it can be a benign mass, it can be borderline, it can be malignant ovarian. Okay. Different
Yes,
types
ma'am.
of ovarian masses are differential diagnosis. Then what else? Lower abdominal pain and abdomen distension, right? Any other
Yes,
thing?
ma'am.
What else the patient can have?
I'm like ascites and
Yeah, she can have ascites. Yes. So ascites. So all causes of ascites. So again, gynecological aspects. You are more worried about ovarian malignancy. But can you have benign conditions of the ovary, which can lead on to ascites?
No, yes, ma'am. Like granulosa cell tumors, fibroma,
Not
which
granulosa cell tumors, fibromas. Okay, so
fibroma.
fibromas, ovarian fibromas associated with ascites is called, what is it called?
Meek syndrome,
Meek
ma'am.
syndrome. Okay, so you can have ovarian fibromas with ascites. So ascites is one cause. See, ascites can occur in other things. Like I'm talking about a gynecological perspective. Now you
Yes,
can
ma'am.
have ascites in tuberculosis. Very commonly we see TB abdomen. Okay, lower abdomen pain, distension, patient will have ascites. Okay, so that is one. So you see, when you're talking about distension, you are thinking of some mass lesion, number one. So mass lesion can be your ovary or fibroid. That is second is fluid. You said ascites. Okay. Then anything else which can cause lower abdomen distension, lower abdomen pain. Anything else?
Ma'am, like encysted tuberculosis.
What is come again?
Encysted tuberculosis, ma'am.
Yeah, tuberculosis. That's what ascites. DDs for ascites. So most commonly you will have, apart from malignant ovarian and tuberculosis is one condition. Okay. Then what else? Anything in the GC? What are the other organs present in the pelvis? Apart from uterus, ovaries, what else you can have?
I'm like a full bladder, ma'am.
Yeah, but full bladder, the patient will have some kind of, okay, fine. See, very rare to have chronic retention like this. Okay. The patient would have had some kind of urinary symptom. Okay. Even though that comes under very last differential diagnosis, but you can have probably. Okay. Then, see, lower abdomen pain means the DD becomes much more. Okay. Because this patient has got a combination of distension and pain. So you're coming down, you're coming down to a few more, only of the few conditions, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Anything to do with GI?
Yes, ma'am. Like GI cancers can also present in the
Not only
abdomen.
cancer. See, if the patient got ulcerative colitis, okay, the patient will have localized, abdominal, because the patient will have gaseous distension, then the
Yes, ma'am.
patient will have altered bowel habits, okay, and lower abdomen pain. So all of this can have any kind. See, if the patient got even amebiasis, ulcerative, inflammatory conditions of the bowel, then of course benign polyps usually will not present like this. Of course, GI malignancies. Again, the patient can come to you with distension and lower abdomen pain. You understand? So
Yes,
all
ma'am.
of this. When the patient 48 years comes to you with all of this complaints, you will have to ask history to rule out any of this condition. You understand? Your negative
Yes, ma'am.
history, you should have, see, you focused on ovarian malignancy, so you're telling everything, the all your you scroll down your history, yeah, about acne, hirsutism, everything related to this. Okay, now you
Yes,
tell
ma'am.
me what other negative history you want. Now if you have a fibroid, if you're thinking in terms of a fibroid, okay, what other history you would like to know if you want to pin it down to a fibroid? If you have a mass abdomen, okay, and what other
Yes, ma'am.
history will be associated with it to say it is probably a fibroid? Not always, but maybe.
It can be associated with infertility.
Not necessarily. Fibroids need not be associated with infertility. Menorrhagia, menstrual disturbances. Okay, so usually
Yes,
when
ma'am.
you have a mass abdomen with, polymenorrhagia, okay, some kind of menstrual, not amenorrhea, menstrual disturbances, right? Menorrhagia, if you have, then you probably think there is, you have a mass and you have menstrual disturbances, you probably think in terms of a fibroid, right? Okay,
Yes, ma'am.
you understand? So
Yes, ma'am.
can you tell some conditions wherein you have menorrhagia and an ovarian mass, or some menstrual disturbances, amenorrhea and an ovarian mass? Or when can these ovarian mass be associated with a menstrual disturbance?
Yes, ma'am. Like adenomyosis, pelvic inflammatory disease,
Ovarian
like.
mass, I'm talking about ovarian mass. See, adenomyosis, uterine mass with
Yes.
menorrhagia. Okay, so but
Yes,
when
ma'am.
you have an ovarian mass, but when can you have a menstrual disturbance?
I'm like a granulosa cell tumor, ma'am, due
Yes,
to
good.
increased production
Granulosa,
of
have a hormone
estrogen.
secreting tumor. So you
Yes,
can
ma'am.
have not only menorrhagia, you can also have amenorrhea. Okay, when estrogen is
Yes,
high,
ma'am.
the patient can also come to you with amenorrhea with ovarian mass. Or the patient can have, if the patient has already developed endometrial hyperplasia or endometrial cancer, you can have granulosa cell induced endometrial hyperplasia and endometrial cancer. Okay, so then the
Yes, ma'am.
patient will have menorrhagia. You understand? So,
Yes, ma'am.
or when you have an advanced, or when you have a coexisting endometrial cancer. You can have endometrioid cancers of the ovary associated with endometrioid cancers of the uterus. Okay, they are called synchronous tumors. So if you have these both tumors together, again you can have an ovarian mass with menorrhagia. Okay, so yes, when you, so history wise, so if you have a menstrual disturbance, you have to think in terms of either a fibroid or these different types of ovarian masses. Okay, then yes, supposing ma'am. The patient has got a GI, you're thinking in terms of ulcerative colitis. So you will have to say, see, this patient has got distension, the lower abdomen pain is there, the pain is not related to the periods. You have to mention not related to her periods. Okay, so supposing she's got dysmenorrhea associated with it, then you will probably attribute it more towards a fibroid or adenomyosis or something like that. You get it? Okay, yes, now second is supposing you're thinking in terms of a GI pathology. Okay, so you will have to say if the pain is associated with defecation or not, or relieved with defecation. Does she have altered bowel habits? Okay, and that has to be related to this. You understand? She, I presume she doesn't have any of this, because those are important negative history in this particular case. You understand? So now this patient has come to you with only a mass lesion, I mean a lower abdomen distension, okay, with some pain. Okay, so with that, you'll probably come down to either an ovarian mass or a fibroid, which is subserosal. She doesn't have menstrual disturbance. The periods are regular, right?
Yes, ma'am.
So you probably will come down to an ovarian mass lesion or some mass lesion. See, ovary, when you're thinking in terms of differential for an ovarian, you even have mesenteric cysts and other things, which will present to you again with abdominal distension and pain. You understand? So these are all the differences as of now from your history. Okay, now we'll go on to your examination. Okay, so with this history in mind, now you have to tell me examination and think, tell me what are the positive things you pick up. Tell me.
Yes, ma'am. Patient is moderately built and nourished, pallor present, and pallor may be due to some like anemic causes.
No, pallor may be because.
Due to some like
speak up, I can't hear you properly.
Pallor may be due to some nutritional deficiency or any chronic disease like that, ma'am.
Okay, she could be, you know that she's got anemia. We'll see what the reason is. Okay, next.
Okay, ma'am.
That patient, no, on history, did you say she's got loss of appetite and loss of weight?
No, ma'am, I said only she has some early satiety, ma'am.
She's got early satiety. What does it signify?
Yes, ma'am.
What does it signify?
Like, she doesn't take that food. She doesn't get all the required nutrients from that food, ma'am.
No, that is a reason for anemia. Fine. But in this particular case, when the patient is complaining of early satiety, does she have dyspepsia? Or
no, ma'am.
Got bloating? Does she have bloating?
No, ma'am. She has ascitic fluid, ma'am. So due to that, pressure symptoms, she feel early satiety.
See, that is so. You will have, she's got early satiety, you have dyspepsia, she's got upper abdominal, any upper abdominal discomfort she's got, this patient?
No, ma'am.
No, no upper abdominal symptoms at all?
No, ma'am. No, ma'am.
Okay. Now tell me why this patient can have early satiety.
Like, if ma'am, the mass put some pressure symptoms on GI tract, due to that she can have early satiety.
You, what is the commonest presentation of ovarian malignancy? Usually what is the symptomatology? What is the commonest ovarian malignancy that you see?
Serous cystadenoma.
Serous?
Cystadenocarcinoma.
Serous cystadenoma. You have two varieties of serous cystadenocarcinoma. What two varieties? One is a high grade, second is a low grade. Have you heard of a low grade serous carcinoma? You have one thing called a high grade serous carcinoma, and the second is the low grade serous carcinoma. They two belong to two different pathways of origin. A low grade very, very rarely becomes a high grade. You understand? Low grade starts off in a different pathway, a high grade starts off in a different pathway. Do you know about the different pathways of origin of ovarian malignancy, epithelial ovarian cancer? What is a type 1 cancer? What is a type 2 cancer?
No,
No.
ma'am.
Okay. See, basically, when you're so what is the etiology for ovarian? See, when you're ovarian is a huge topic. Okay. So
Yes,
now
ma'am.
we will talk only pertaining to your case. So your
Yes, ma'am.
case is most probably an epithelial ovarian malignancy. Okay. So what are the
Yes,
other
ma'am.
types of ovarian malignancy you can have? You can have, apart from
Epithelial,
epithelial, you can have.
germinal,
You can have
stromal,
germ cell, you can have stromal, okay. You can have metastatic tumors, you have other different varieties. We are not going there, okay.
Yes,
Now
ma'am.
we will stick to epithelial ovarian malignancies, right? Now,
Yes, ma'am.
epithelial ovarian malignancies, what is the etiology? Why does it occur? Tell me
Etiology,
how it
ma'am.
comes. From where it comes, like what is the source and see, when you talk about CA cervix, you know you have HPV, HPV induced carcinogenesis, and you get CA cervix. Now, like
Yes,
that,
ma'am.
how does an ovarian malignancy come? Epithelial ovarian cancer. CF2 pathways, okay,
Yes,
a
ma'am.
type 1 and a type 2 pathway. Now, this type 1 cancer arises from these benign cysts, okay? So, you have
Yes,
serous
ma'am.
cystadenoma, the mucinous cystadenoma, these are benign cysts. Some of these disappear. Some of these will start progressing. Okay. Remember,
Yes, ma'am.
cancer is a disease of mutations. You have different types of mutation affecting different cancers. Okay. So,
Yes,
in this
ma'am.
type 1 pathway, you have the serous tumors which undergo mutation. They become borderline tumors. Okay. You have serous borderline, mucinous borderline. Then it
Yes, ma'am.
becomes a low-grade malignancy, low-grade serous carcinoma. That is one pathway. Okay. The type 2 cancers, they are different from the type 1 cancers. They are the common ones you see, the aggressive ones, high-grade ones that you commonly see are type 2 cancers. Okay. They arise from the tube. They don't arise from the ovary. You understand? They
Yes,
arise
ma'am.
from the tube. Basically, tube is the source of the cancer. So from the tube, you have something called tubal intraepithelial carcinomatous cells. They spill over the ovary, okay. And over the peritoneum, and then that's how it causes all these deposits, and then you have the ovarian mass. So primarily, these type 2 cancers arise from the tube. You understand? They are
Yes,
not
ma'am.
primarily from the ovary. You're primarily from the ovary masses are the type 1 cancers. These are two different pathways. Okay, you
Yes,
understand?
ma'am.
That is why in a type 2 cancer, when they present, it comes from the tubes and it spills. Okay, spills in the peritoneal cavity. What is very specific about the epithelial, the type of spread of epithelial ovarian cancer? What is very, very peculiar about the type of spread of epithelial ovarian cancer?
Transgenomic spread, ma'am.
Normally, how all does a malignancy spread?
I'm like
From what
from
type?
a transgenomic spread and retrograde
Yes.
lymphatic, ma'am.
See, usually it is, see, that transgenomic spread is very peculiar to epithelial ovarian cancer. Of course, you have some other malignancies which can have a transgenomic spread. But epithelial ovarian cancer is very peculiar that it causes this dissemination. These cells disseminate within the peritoneal cavity and then they form deposits all over the abdomen. You understand?
Yes,
So,
ma'am.
these deposits, very commonly, what is the most common site of deposit within the abdominal cavity?
Like, ma'am, peritoneum or
In the omentum, okay,
omentum, yes, ma'am.
omentum is the most important. So that is why in a part of staging, you have to remove the omentum for staging purposes. Because
Yes, ma'am.
omentum, normal looking omentum itself will harbor, microscopic implants. Okay, so
Yes,
very,
ma'am.
very, because that omentum is free hanging, right? It goes around like that. So it picks up all these cells. So usually omentum is the most common site of deposit. So what happens is when you have this omentum deposits, you have something called an omental caking. It becomes big and it forms a cake-like thing and it drags on to the where is the omentum attached? Upper part of it. Now where what are the attachments of the omentum? Greater omentum. Now where is it attached?
Ma'am, from a stomach, ma'am,
It is
like.
attached to the stomach, comes down and lower part gets attached to the transverse colon. You understand?
Ma'am.
So it
Yes,
is
ma'am.
between the stomach and the transverse colon. You have this big sheath. So when you have this caking, it drags on to the stomach. You understand? So that
Yes,
is the
ma'am.
reason it causes this dyspeptic symptoms, and that is the commonest presentation of your epithelial ovarian cancer. So whenever you have an epithelial ovarian cancer, your lower abdomen pain or distension are not the commonest presentation. Patient will have this dyspeptic symptoms, early satiety, not able to eat, just like a GI cancer, just like a stomach cancer. That will be the commonest symptom the patient will present to you with. Okay. Okay.
Yes,
Come
ma'am.
down. Examination. Go ahead. Yeah.
Ah, yes, ma'am. No ictus, no cyanosis, no clubbing, no pedal edema, no significant generalized lymphadenopathy, no supraclavicular or inguinal lymph node enlargement.
Okay.
Vitals are normal with the pulse
okay.
80 per minute, BP 110 by 70 mmHg, respiratory
okay.
rate 17 per minute, temperature
okay.
afebrile. She has BMI
okay.
of 22.3 kg per meter square. Breast
okay.
examination was normal. Spine was normal. Thyroid examination, thyroid was not enlarged. Respiratory systems like normal vesicular breath sound heard, no added sound. CVS examination,
wait,
S1,
tell
S2
me
heard.
Particular to this case, one second. Very, very
yes, ma'am.
Specific for this particular case. You are thinking in terms of an ovarian, okay? So general
yes, ma'am.
Examination, what finding you can expect? Now, these are things that you can probably have very commonly in these cases. So importantly, what you should not miss. You've told all this. Come down, but you don't. You just scroll down a little bit. Yeah. See, you will not get cyanosis. You will not get clubbing. Okay. Jaundice
yes,
also
ma'am.
Is very rare. Okay. Anemia you can have basically because nutritional reason, as you said.
Yes, ma'am.
The patient will not have eaten properly. Okay. Nutritional reasons for pallor. Okay. Pedal edema.
Yes, ma'am.
Does she have pedal edema?
No, ma'am.
She doesn't have pedal edema, but reasons for pedal edema in this case, how at all she can have pedal edema?
I'm like when the mass in abdomen obstruct the
yes, so
venous
obstructive,
drainage
yeah,
off
yes
from the lower limb, ma'am.
Yes, so the mass, either the mass itself can obstruct or the patient can have large lymph node masses, no, lymphadenopathy,
yes,
which
ma'am.
Can again compress on these lymphatics or venous return. Again, the patient can have pedal edema. Okay,
pedal edema.
Then supraclavicular, very, very important. Okay, so if the
yes,
patient
ma'am.
Got a supraclavicular node or if the patient got a suspicious inguinal node, large node, hard node, fixed node, okay, or any
yes,
supraclavicular node, okay, so then
yes,
what will be the stage?
It would be stage 4, ma'am.
It would be stage 4. Very important. That is why you'll have to pick that up. Okay. Now,
yes,
and then, why did you examine the breast?
Ma'am, if there is any like a metastasis from uterus or there is any origin of tumor from breast and all, ma'am.
See, two reasons. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
See, from the ovary, very rare for you. You will not get a breast metastasis from the ovary. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
But from the breast, you can have a primary in the breast and then you can have a metastasis in the ovary. Very rare. It's not very common. So you have
yes,
something called a Krukenberg's tumor from a primary breast. Okay. The lobular
yes,
carcinoma, breast, you have different types of carcinoma, ductal carcinoma, lobular carcinoma, right? Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
So lobular carcinoma, you can have this kind of cirrhosis spread. You can have ascites. Okay.
Yes,
typically,
ma'am.
Like an ovarian malignancy, the patient can come to you with ascites, peritoneal deposits and ovarian mass. Okay. So that is a rare possibility. The more common reason that you are doing a breast examination is to pick up an incidental breast primary. Can you have breast primaries associated with ovarian malignancies, synchronous tumors, both occurring together? Can you have in certain situations?
Ma'am, maybe, ma'am, we can have, ma'am.
So when you have both primaries like that, what will you suspect?
Ma'am, like it can be due to some hormonal, excessive hormone secretion.
Not because of excessive hormone. See, what, see you, why did you ask for family history and all?
Yes, ma'am. It can be like there is some genes which
what
can occur
gene?
In
what gene?
BRCA1 and BRCA2.
Yeah, so you have to see. We very commonly we see it. It's not that it's not common in India. We see families wherein you have clusters of breast ovarian cancers. Okay,
yes,
so
ma'am.
Same patient itself can have breast primary and an ovarian primary. It is a possibility. So that is the reason you are looking for breast examination. More importantly, okay. Second
yes,
reason is breast primary with ovarian secondary. That is why you're looking. Okay. Then come down.
Yes,
what else is there? Scroll it a little up. Okay. And respiratory system. Very important. Why you want to do a proper respiratory examination for this case?
Because due to some metastasis from ovary to the lung, it may cause hydrothorax, which can
yes. So pleural
breathing.
Effusion is very common. Okay. Very common. You
yes,
get
ma'am.
Pleural effusion in ovarian malignancy. Just like ascites. You can have this these cells which go into the pleural cavity, and you can have pleural deposits, and you can have pleural effusion. So very commonly you will have to look for presence of pleural effusion. Okay. Okay, inspection.
Yes, ma'am. Abdominal inspection. Abdomen distended below umbilicus. Umbilicus is in midline and inverted. Skin over swelling normal. No dilated veins. No scars. All quadrant move with respiration. Hernial orifice free. Flanks free.
Okay.
Palpation. No, not warm. Not tender. Size of mass 13 into 8 centimeter was found.
You didn't even tell me size. There is a mass. Then you're starting off with size of mass. You will have to tell. No, you said only. See, so far you've told there is one lower abdomen distension felt. So when you're describing on palpation, you will have to tell. So there is a mass felt occupying which quadrant first? Okay. Oh, tell me.
Okay,
yeah.
Okay, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. The mass felt occupying the left and right iliac fossa. Extended up hypogastrium, extended up to umbilicus with the mass of size 13 into 8 centimeter, bilaterally present, variable in consistency. Yes,
okay. Surface irregular. And how do you know it's bilateral? See this mass, then you'll have to say, describe two different masses. You understand? If you say one mass, then how do you say it's bilateral? You have just copied down the scan findings, right?
Yes, ma'am, from a senior man.
See, clinical examination is most important. Okay, so do not compromise on your clinical examination skills. Very, very important. Okay, so if you are able to feel a mass from left iliac fossa or right iliac fossa and hypogastrium extending up to umbilicus. So what are the things you have to describe about this mass? Tell me.
I'm like... what is the consistency of this mass?
What is the consistency? Well, you said for what is the variable and consistency? Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
And then what else?
The surface of the mass, ma'am. Is it smooth
or surface? You said irregular. Then what else?
Ma'am, it's margin, ma'am. Like
So all borders are felt. That's what you mean.
Yes, ma'am.
See, why is it important in this case?
I'm like in a.
If lower border is felt or not, is it important or not?
Is it don't know, ma'am.
See, if you have a mass, see what, remember you have a pelvic bone there, right?
Yes,
and you have
yes,
a pelvic
ma'am.
Cavity. Okay. So this ovary, uterus, and all are pelvic organs. They are normally present within the pelvic cavity. Okay. So supposing you have a mass arising from the uterus, you have a big mass. Okay. The lower border of the mass you will not be able to reach. It will go within the cavity, right?
Yes,
okay.
Ma'am.
The lower border, if you are able to reach, then that means that mass is above. It has come within the abdomen. You understand? So
yes,
it's
ma'am.
A separate mass. It will probably be a pedunculated fibroid. Suppose you're thinking in terms of fibroid, it will be a pedunculated fibroid, which is attached with a pedicle. So only then you will be able to feel the lower border. Okay. Now, if it is coming like that along the same uterus, if it comes like that, lower border you will not able to reach at all, right? It's going within the pelvis.
Yes,
so if all borders are felt, lower border not felt, that means a part of the mass is within the pelvis. You understand? So even
yes,
in ovarian malignancies, ovarian masses, a lot of times you may not be able to reach the lower border. Lower border felt means the mass is freely mobile like that and it has come up. Okay, it is out
yes,
of the pelvis into the abdomen. You understand? Very, very important finding. Next time you see a case, you specifically look for every border, look whether you're able to feel the lower border or not. Okay.
Yes,
so, if you feel the lower border, that means the mass is no longer within the pelvis.
From,
it is totally
yes,
into
from,
the abdomen. Okay.
Abdomen.
And next thing is, you have to see whether the mass is mobile. Okay. Once
yes,
you're able to feel the lower border, that means that the mass is generally mobile. Very rarely you will have a mass where you feel the lower border and the mass is fixed. Okay? That usually doesn't occur in ovarian malignancies. Okay? You understand?
Yes,
so usually when you have a fixed mass like that, it usually fixes up in the pelvis. It doesn't fix up in the abdomen. You understand? So these
yes,
are all contradictory findings in your palpation. So that is why I'm telling you, clinical examination is important. In this case, most probably you'll have a mass which you don't feel the lower border and which has got a restricted mobility. You're not able to see vertical axis. You will never be able to move. It will be because it's all attached down. transversely, horizontally, you will be able to move a lot of times, or you may have restricted mobility. Okay,
Okay,
you will
yes,
have
ma'am.
to say whether it is freely mobile. So if it's freely mobile, means that is a nice mass like that attached to the ovary or wherever, and it is moving. It's an easy case. Okay,
Yes,
whereas
ma'am.
when you have fixity, when you have restriction in mobility, that means that either the mass itself is big or it is attached to some other structure. You understand? So these are all
Yes, ma'am.
things that you will have to talk in terms of the mass. And of course, you have to talk about tenderness, because sometimes when you will have a mass which was freely mobile sometime. Okay, then what will
Yes,
happen?
ma'am.
The patient will have a torsion. Okay, then with a subacute or an acute torsion, she'll start developing adhesions, bowel, everything to it. Then the mobility will be restricted. But the problem is, it will be tender. Okay, you will have
Yes,
a
ma'am.
mass like that. The mass got restricted mobility and it's got tenderness. So you will have to say whether it is tender or not. These are the things. So if you have a tender mass, then you'll have to think in terms of acute pathology, whether it is rotated, whether it's twisted within itself, or whether there is bleeding within it, all other things that you'll have to. Now, this case, it is not tender, so you probably have a mass there. Okay. Okay, next.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Mass is fixed in horizontal axis. That
Okay.
means it has restricted mobility.
Okay.
No hepatosplenomegaly. Then percussion was dullness over the mass and
Okay.
shifting dullness present,
Bowel
which
sounds.
tells that is ascites.
Okay. So this
And
now you have a
auscultation.
mass.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Okay, now summarize the
Yes, ma'am.
pelvic examination you haven't done. Okay, so but if you do a bimanual pelvic examination, what are the findings you are expected to see? What are the other examinations? See, your examination is incomplete without a pelvic examination or a parochial
Yes, ma'am.
examination. So at least tell me what are the things you want to look for in a pelvic
Yes, ma'am.
examination. Yeah.
Yes, ma'am. If a mass has origin from uterus, then during bimanual examination, if we lift the mass from abdomen, the endocervix will also move, ma'am. If the mass is originating from the cervix, from uterus, ma'am.
Yeah, okay.
And
Which means that
if
is, you will have to say the movement of the mass is transmitted to the cervix. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so you move the mass and you keep your finger touching the cervix when you move it, and then your movement will be transmitted to the cervix. That means that
Yes,
mass
ma'am.
is either arising from the uterus or it is adherent to the uterus. That's all. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
If the movement of the mass is not transmitted to the cervix, then that mass is away from the uterus. It's not attached to the uterus, it is separate. Okay,
Yes, ma'am.
remember, when you have a pedunculated fibroid, the movement of the mass need not be transmitted to the cervix. It is still arising from the uterus, but it will not
Yes,
be
ma'am.
transmitted. The other fallacy is, when you have an ovarian mass like this, fixed to the uterus, the movement of the mass will be transmitted to the cervix. So it's not 100% foolproof. Okay,
Yes,
generally,
ma'am.
when you have to correlate with other things, then you can come to a conclusion. Okay, then
Yes,
so
ma'am.
number one is movement of the mass, then what else you will feel?
Like we can feel uterovesical ovarian ridge, ma'am, which
The groove sign. Okay,
yes, ma'am.
supposing you
Yes, ma'am.
have a
Groove sign,
mass
ma'am.
like that inside and you're able to insinuate in your finger between the cervix and the mass, then that is called groove sign positive, which means that probably that it is an ovarian mass. Okay,
Yes, ma'am.
so you have to feel for where the mass is felt in which fornix, whether it is mobile or it is fixed. Sometimes you feel the mass within the fornix, and when you tap it, no, it moves up. That means that it comes and rests there in the pouch of Douglas, and when you tap it, it moves up, which means that it is a mobile mass. But sometimes the mass is totally fixed and attached to the pouch of Douglas. That is the sign of malignancy. So whenever you have attachment to the pouch of Douglas, when you have a mass which is fixed to the pouch of Douglas, only
Yes,
two
ma'am.
things mainly. Okay, one is your malignancy. Okay,
Yes,
second
ma'am.
is what else most commonly you see?
Pouch of Douglas. Endometriosis.
Endometriosis. Yes. So
Yes,
when you have
yes, ma'am.
chocolate cysts,
Yes, ma'am.
endometriosis will be adherent to the pouch of Douglas. Okay. So very
Yes, ma'am.
commonly, your uterus also will be pulled on. So you will have a fixed retroversion. Everything will be stuck like that in the pouch of Douglas in endometriosis. Okay. Of course,
Yes,
in
ma'am.
PID also you can have, but endometriosis is very classical picture. Okay. So that is very important. So when you have this fixed masses, no, you have to think in either in terms, but endometriosis, very rarely you will have such a big mass. You can have, but it is usually very uncommon. Large masses,
yes,
okay. Usually this occupying up to the level of umbilicus endometriosis is quite rare. Okay, endometriosis are usually smaller masses, like say maximum 10-12 centimeters masses only. Usually you will get, very occasionally this size. Okay, but these kind of malignancies, obviously you can have these large masses. Okay, so when you have this fixed to the pouch of Douglas, your first diagnosis again with ascites, endometriosis you will not have ascites. Ascites, your first diagnosis will be ovarian
cancer.
And why do we have to do a perrectal examination for this case?
Perrectal, yes, ma'am. To feel like is there any deposits in pouch of Douglas?
It is. You shouldn't think an answer. It is the most important examination you have to do. Okay, because when you do a perrectal examination, when you will feel these pouch of Douglas deposits nicely only by PR. Sometimes seen by pervaginal examination, you will not feel at all. Only by PR.
Yes, ma'am.
Douglas deposits. Okay. So this case, after examination, okay, I'll tell you, she's got pouch of Douglas deposits. Now, how are you going to proceed with managing? What is your diagnosis?
It's abdominal mass with ascites. It's probable diagnosis of malignant ovarian tumor, ma'am. Hello?
See, malignant ovarian, I told you the patient has got pouch of Douglas deposits. So whether it is an early ovarian or an advanced ovarian?
Ma'am, it's an advanced ovarian, it can be stage 2 ovarian tumor, ma'am.
Yeah, so it can be, so anything in the pelvis, it's stage 2B, okay, POD deposit.
Yes,
so
ma'am.
It is still comes under advanced only, right, and the current classification, okay. So early ovarian,
yes,
is only those masses are confined to the ovary, okay. So this is most probably an advanced ovarian malignancy, okay. So, what are the factors? Because she's got ascites and she's got POD deposits and, of course, ovarian mass. Now, how are you going to evaluate this patient?
Yes, ma'am. About management, ma'am.
Yeah, tell me.
Yes, ma'am.
Tell me investigations. What are you going to do?
Ma'am, complete blood count, ma'am. Hemoglobin, RBC, WBC, differential count, bleeding time, clotting time, blood grouping, RS typing. Then blood urea, serum creatinine, blood sugar, urine albumin sugar, chest X-ray, liver function test, ECG.
So all these you are doing for a purpose of anesthetic fitness. So why are you doing all these tests?
Yes, ma'am. If we need to remove the ovarian mass, then we for anesthetic fitness, we should all.
So for number one investigations for the sake of anesthetic general investigations, all of these fine. What else you will do? For pertaining to the mass, no, this is all your clinical diagnosis. No, don't you want to confirm with something?
Yes, ma'am. Like, ma'am, with chest X-ray, we need to rule out that there is no metastasis to the lung, ma'am. There is no hydrothorax and all.
Okay.
And any
other investigations you will do directly? First thing, first line investigation you will do for this case, what pertaining to the tumor.
USG abdomen.
USG, ma'am. Okay. With a USG abdomen, when you're doing, can you pick up hydrothorax or not? Very easily you can pick up. Okay. Water, anyway, you can easily pick up. So, for the purpose of pleural effusion, you don't have to do a chest X-ray. Remember that. Okay. When you're doing an ultrasound itself, when you just put a probe there, you will easily pick up fluid within the pleural cavity. You understand?
Yes,
so don't have to basically go and do a chest. Of course, chest X-ray, I agree. Because for investigations, for fitness and other things, you do a chest X-ray, you will also pick up pleural effusion. But pleural effusion, you can pick up even minimal amount of pleural effusion, you can pick up by an ultrasound. Remember that. Okay. So you're doing an ultrasound. And what are the findings you're looking for ultrasound? What are the things you're going to look for?
Like, ma'am, we confirm the consistency or of a mass, ma'am.
You confirmed if there is a mass, number one. And secondly, site of origin of the mass. You confirm, when you do an ultrasound, you'll know, right, if the uterus is normal or not, whether you're able to see the ovary separately. Okay. So you'll know you will be able to at least tell to a certain extent that it is a uterine mass or a ovarian mass separately.
Yeah.
Okay. So now second is to confirm the site of the mass. And then what else? What are the other things?
Like, ma'am, the consistency of that mass, ma'am, if it is cystic or it is a solid, ma'am, like that. With that, we can rule out it. Is it benign or malignant?
So how will you rule out? What are the factors in an ultrasound which will predict malignancy?
In a malignancy, that mass would have a thick septa, ma'am, and it has
Okay.
solid consistency.
Yes. So if you have a solid areas, solid,
Yes,
especially
ma'am.
solid areas, when you put in Doppler along with vascularity, then you have thick
Yes, ma'am.
septa. Okay. And of course, when you have presence of ascites and omental deposits, which you're able to feel, all of these are pointers towards malignancy. Okay.
Malignant tumor, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So you've done an ultrasound and your mass is like how you described. Okay. What else will you do?
I'm like, we do Doppler, ma'am, to
Yeah.
find out the vascularity of the mass, ma'am.
Yeah, that's what. Ultrasound and Doppler together. Doppler is not a
Oh,
separate
yes,
imaging.
ma'am.
You just got to put a button. Same ultrasound,
Okay,
push
ma'am.
a button, and then you're going to say ultrasound and Doppler done. Then
Then,
what
ma'am,
else?
we'll do CT MRI, ma'am, to rule out any metastasis and any lymph node enlargement and
Will
all,
you
ma'am.
do CT or will you do MRI? Boy, you can't say both. You'll send the patient, when you're writing a request, you'll write CT MRI. Yeah? You'll write only, see, both invest, you'll ask them to do both and come. Huh?
No, ma'am.
And then one or two, both, you will ask them to do both. Huh?
Don't know, ma'am.
See, you are in the clinic and see,
Yes,
the
ma'am.
CT scan is going to cost 3,000 rupees or 4,000 rupees. I'm just telling you. MRI is going to cost 6,000 rupees. The similar thing, results only you'll get from both. When you send you, if you say CT MRI, they will do both and send back to you, right? Why
Yes,
unnecessarily
ma'am.
two modalities to get the same thing?
Yes, ma'am. Then we'll go with CT scan, ma'am.
See, you have to choose. Okay.
Yes,
Most
ma'am.
probably this case, you already know that she's got some malignant ovarian mass. Okay. So
Yes,
what is
ma'am.
your purpose? Ultrasound itself told that you've got a solid lesion, everything. Okay. So what
Yes,
is
ma'am.
the purpose of doing a CT?
To like rule out any metastasis to
Yes.
other
So you
organs.
want to know the degree of spread of lesion. Okay.
Yes,
How
ma'am.
much it has gone, whether the liver is involved, whether you have deposits outside. So you want to know, why do you want to know the how much the disease is spread? What is the reason?
Like according to that, we will have management, ma'am, and
Yes.
survival index of that patient
Yeah,
depends on.
prognostication is one reason. The
Yes,
second
ma'am.
reason for management itself, you need to know whether the disease is amenable for surgery or it is not operable. So you want to assess operability. You
Yes,
understand?
ma'am.
If you have extensive disease, okay, extensive upper abdominal disease, supposing you have liver, intraparenchymal liver metastasis, if you have lung metastasis, okay, if you have something like that, which means that it is beyond surgery now, right now, you can't do surgery. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Whereas if you have just the omental deposits and just small deposits here and there, not much of peritoneal disease, then you can probably think in terms of surgery upfront. Okay. So to decide whether you are going for surgery or chemotherapy upfront, you need to assess the extent of disease. That is the reason why you're doing CT. So the
Yes,
best
ma'am.
CT is not plain CT. You have to do a contrast CT, abdomen and pelvis. You have to give IV contrast. You have to give bowel contrast, okay,
Yes, ma'am.
oral contrast. So then, so that bowel is opacified, so you'll know whether this mass is around bowel, everything, okay. So
Yes,
now
ma'am.
you're going to use, so that is the reason you do a CT. CT
Yes,
to
ma'am.
assess the extent of disease, to assess operability. So sometimes, this is the case wherein you have an advanced presentation. Sometimes you can have early ovarian, a patient can come to you just with an ovarian mass, without ascites, without peritoneal deposit, anything, right? So
Yes, ma'am.
that time you only have a mass abdomen. So that time you're not very sure. It can be before 48 years, you can have benign conditions, you can have dermoid cysts. All of those are differential diagnosis of your early ovarian cancer, right? You can
Yes,
have
ma'am.
hypersulfinx, you can have PID, you can have endometriosis. All of these are differential diagnosis of early ovarian cancer. So when you have all these benign counterparts as differentials, then MRI will score over. Okay. When you do an
Yes, ma'am.
MRI, you get a better picture to characterize that mass, what is there within the mass, whether there is blood inside, whether there is fat inside. Everything is made out well by an MRI. You understand?
Yes, ma'am.
So that case, that scenario, you do an MRI. Whereas in this scenario, like your case, wherein you know already that it's probably an ovarian malignancy,
Malignant, yes, ma'am.
better to do a contrast CT, abdomen
Yes,
and
ma'am.
pelvis. Now you've done a contrast CT and she's
Yes,
got
ma'am.
extensive disease. So what is your aim of surgery? Supposing you've got a plan for surgery for her upfront now. Okay,
Yes,
what is
ma'am.
your aim now? You know she's ovarian malignancy. So what is your aim right now?
We'll
What are you
do.
going to do in surgery? Supposing you go and do surgery for her,
Yes, ma'am.
what are you going to do?
We'll do total abdominal hysterectomy and bilateral salpingo oophorectomy as she's completed, as she's of a premenopausal age.
See, so you if you have a 28-year-old lady again with the same problem, this
Yes,
advanced
ma'am.
presentation, again you will have to do completion only. It is tumor directed, right?
Yes,
Okay,
ma'am.
if you so it is not dependent on the age group. Okay, fertility preservation in malignant ovarian will happen only in very very early stages. Stage one only when it's confined to the ovary. When it is low grade tumor only, you can preserve fertility. If you have a high grade cancer presenting to you,
Yes,
okay,
ma'am.
even in younger age groups like this advanced presentation, you will have to do complete surgery only. But in
Yes, ma'am.
advanced presentation, you have to confirm. So when you open up, supposing the patient is 28 years, you take off a part
Yes,
of the
ma'am.
tumor, send it for frozen section, make sure it is a high grade tumor, and then come back and complete the full surgery. That's all. You understand?
Yes, ma'am.
So in this
Okay, yes,
case,
ma'am.
so the idea is to remove the tumor fully as much as possible. Okay. So the
Yes,
at
ma'am.
the end of this patient has already got deposits, which means that the disease is already either stage two or stage three. It's gone up. It is above.
Yes,
It's
ma'am.
not stage one. Okay.
Yes,
So
ma'am.
that means that you will have you anticipate deposits. So you go ahead and do something called a primary cytoreduction or debulking, wherein you
Yes, ma'am.
remove maximal tumor.
All
So
the
at the end of
possible, yes,
surgery,
ma'am.
how much residual disease you are allowed to leave behind? Or what will be your idea when you're going and doing a surgery? What is your idea? How much do you think you should remove?
I'm like in this case, ma'am, or advanced stage, ma'am?
This is all the advance only, no. This case only
Yes,
you are
ma'am.
opening up and you have large mass and you have omental peritoneal deposits. So what are you going to do? You said
Ma'am, we
hysterectomy BSO then.
then we'll do infracolic omentectomy, ma'am.
Okay, you're
That
doing a full omentectomy then. Then you have
then.
it's important that you completely inspect the entire abdominal cavity, look for any deposit. Wherever you have a deposit, you have to remove it completely. The idea is at the end of surgery, you should not have any macroscopic residual disease left behind. That is the idea of your surgery. Okay,
Yes, ma'am.
that is called optimal cytoreduction. Okay, so
Yes, ma'am.
maximum you can leave behind 1 centimeter residue at any particular place, but the best thing you can do for the patient is leave behind no residue. Okay, see, sometimes what will happen, you will have these small residues present over the small bowel. Full small bowel, you will have small deposit. Very difficult to take that. Okay,
Yes,
so
ma'am.
those things it is okay to leave behind. But wherever else, if you have disease of the diaphragm, you have to strip it and remove the entire disease. Okay, so supposing when you're on a CT scan, if you think that you are not able to completely remove, supposing you have bulky disease, bulky periotic nodes, large volume disease, which is not amenable to surgery, then what you will do?
Ma'am, then we'll first go with the chemotherapy, ma'am, to
Yeah, you will have
reduce
to. What chemotherapy it's called?
some
When you give it before surgery, what do you call it?
debulking, ma'am.
No, it's called chemotherapy. It's called neoadjuvant chemotherapy. Okay, so
Neoadjuvant, okay, ma'am.
before. Neoadjuvant chemotherapy it is called, right? So
Yes, ma'am.
before surgery, whenever your primary modality is surgery, okay,
Yes,
but
ma'am.
before surgery you want to downsize the disease, so you're giving chemotherapy, then you're going to do surgery, right? So that is
Yes, ma'am.
called neoadjuvant chemotherapy. So but before neoadjuvant chemotherapy, you have to make sure that this is cancer, because before chemo you have to make sure it is cancer. So that is when you do a biopsy. Okay, so for
Yes,
this
ma'am.
case, before planning for chemotherapy, you have to do image guided or ultrasound or CT guided biopsy from the mass or from the omental deposits, confirm malignancy, and start with chemotherapy. Okay, now what
Yes,
is
ma'am.
the you've written chemo markers. Now what is the
Yes,
role
ma'am.
of chemo markers?
I'm like this tumor markers like CA125 mostly is increased in the epithelial tumors, and like alpha fetoprotein, HCH, LDH, these are mostly associated with the ovarian tumor,
Yes, so in this
germ cell
case,
tumors.
48-year-old lady, you do not expect a germ cell tumor to occur. So more than 35 years, you don't have to do this AFP HCG and all. Okay.
Okay, ma'am.
So 35 years, up to 35 years, this germ cell tumors can come. So AFP HCG is okay. But
Yes,
this
ma'am.
case, you have to do CA125 and CEA. Carcinoembryonic antigen is important because in mucinous tumors, it can be elevated. Mucinous tumors, CA125 will be normal. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
And sometimes in GI primary and metastasis to the ovary, same presentation will be there, but primarily will be in the colon or stomach. So that time CEA will be elevated. Okay. So for
Yes,
this
ma'am.
case, the most important tumor markers are CA125, not for diagnosis.
Or hello, ma'am. Hello, ma'am.
Okay, so over 100.
Excuse me, ma'am.
Yes.
Ma'am, you are not
Not
audible, ma'am.
audible. Ah.
Ma'am, if audible, ma'am. இதுக்கு முன்னாடி கொஞ்ச நேரம்
Okay,
முன்னாடி
va.
audible.
Okay, okay.
இப்போ okay, ma'am.
Okay. So see the CA125 level, no?
Yes,
Supposing
ma'am.
initially it is 5,000 or something. Okay, it is an important prognostic marker. So after chemotherapy, one cycle you give chemotherapy, you have to keep assessing every month. After this chemotherapy is given, how many days once? Every 21 days. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
So every 21 days you have to give chemotherapy. And what
Yes,
chemo
ma'am.
you give?
For my epithelial, we do carboplatin and
Paclitaxel. Okay.
paclitaxel.
So these are the two doublets you give. So every 21 days you have to keep assessing. You keep assessing with either clinical, number one, clinical examination, second, some kind of imaging, third is CA125.
Yes, ma'am.
Normally, if the patient is responding well, your CA125 drastically come down. Okay, it will even become 100 and all. From 5,000 and all, it will become 100. So much it will drop down. Ascites will all disappear first cycle itself. So that is a good response. So normally,
Yes,
what
ma'am.
you do, you keep assessing the response. After three cycles, you if you think the patient is operable now, you can plan surgery. Okay, what
One
surgery it
question.
is now?
Neoadjuvant.
No, chemotherapy is neoadjuvant chemo. Surgery is interval cytoreduction. Okay.
Yes,
When
ma'am.
you do surgery first, upfront surgery, it's called primary cytoreduction. Okay.
Yes,
As
ma'am.
I told you, if the patient is operable, you directly go ahead and do surgery first. If you
Yes, ma'am.
think the patient is not operable, then you give chemotherapy, which is called neoadjuvant chemotherapy, assess response after three cycles, and then do surgery, and that surgery is called interval cytoreduction. You understand?
Interval cyto, yes, ma'am. Interval
Yeah,
cyto.
interval. So when you do interval, you open up, and now again you have to remove whatever tumor is there, full tumor, you have to remove and come. That is the idea. And then after that, again you
Yes, ma'am.
follow chemotherapy, three more cycles, and that is called adjuvant chemotherapy. Okay.
Adjuvant chemotherapy. Yes, ma'am.
So neoadjuvant chemotherapy, interval cytoreduction, and adjuvant chemotherapy. Okay.
Adjuvant chemotherapy. Yes,
So
ma'am.
after three cycles, then how do you follow up the patient? You follow up the patient every 3 months with clinical examination and CA125 levels. That is the importance of CA125. Now, in the follow-up period, when the CA125 will start increasing, it means that the patient is going to have a recurrence. So
Correct.
that way, CA125 is very important for this patient. Okay.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, pa. I think till 11 only, so we'll finish off. La. If you have any doubt, you can ask. For ovarian tumor is a very huge topic, so only if you read up, you'll get doubts. And if you have doubts, you can anytime come and ask me. If you have anything to ask me, you can ask now.
No, okay. Thank you.
Okay, pa. Okay. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.